On this episode of Wheel of Science, we're talking politics in space, or Space Force. But you gotta say it differently.
Yeah, in space, there are only deep voices. Space Force. This is Wheel of Science.
Hey everybody, what's up and welcome to Wheel of Science. I'm your host, Chuck Nice, and this is the show where we answer your questions about the universe. Actually, I don't answer your questions about the universe, but that would be silly. The one, the only, Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson answers your questions about the universe.
Hey, Chuck.
What's up, Neil?
Doing good. You found me in my office today.
I think this is the longest time that you have been home.
Yeah, sometimes I gotta give the universe a rest.
I disagree with that. I think the universe can handle you, Neil. So, Neil, before we get to the questions, why don't you just tell us, what is Space Force?
Yeah, if that comes to pass, it would just be a sort of a reorganization of the military with a lot of the activities that have already been happening under the auspices of the Air Force. Many people, I don't think, knew the Air Force has a U.S. Space Command within it. And they're the ones that conceived and launched the GPS satellites. They, with the NSA and others, have spy satellites in orbit. This has been going on since the 60s, spy satellites. So this concept that the military use of space is something new, no, it's something old. And all this would do was codify it into a new branch of the armed forces.
So it really already exists. It's like calling an apple pie an apple crisp.
I mean, take an apple pie and hit it with a hammer a few times and call it apple crisp?
That's exactly what I meant. Neil, what time is it, my friend?
It is time to spin the wheel.
My, how formal. Mike Maz wants to know, if and when we colonize another planet, who has political rights over that body?
Welcome to the wild frontier of space law. It's not clear, but the Outer Space Treaty stipulates that you can't own anything in space, so that nations cannot declare it their own. So if that holds up, the answer is nobody has jurisdiction. But I think laws imagined many decades ago may need to be updated and modified given what we learn and know about the future of space exploration. So we're in need of some enlightened attorneys to think this through going forward.
Oh God, more lawyers.
No, better lawyers.
So you mentioned space treaty, what is that?
The Outer Space Treaty was a UN document drafted in the late 1960s, ratified by today more than 100 countries, and it's a guidelines for the peaceful use of outer space, and it's very kumbaya. You know, if your astronaut's in trouble, I come help you and I bring you food and water. And it's very beautiful. It's very future thinking. But it leaves open the possibility that you might want to defend your assets in space with some form of weapon or another. And so suppose you see a satellite coming towards you and you think it's going to hurt you. Can you preemptively take it out so that you don't get hurt? This is the fuzzy area in that document. But that doesn't subtract from the fact that it really is imagining a future, a very peaceful future of cooperation in space, which I think, in the end, is a good idea.
Look at that! Gene Roddenberry couldn't have done a better job himself.
Yep.
All right, Neil, you ready for another one?
Spin the wheel.
Jen Schifrin wants to know this. Don't we already use satellites for military action? What other ways will they militarize space?
Yeah, when people think of the militarization of space, they're often thinking of Star Wars weapons, missiles, and things. Problem is, when you're in space and in orbit, you're going 18,000 miles an hour in low Earth orbit. If you start busting stuff up, now you have particles and bits and pieces of formerly operating satellites that are themselves projectiles moving at 18,000 miles an hour. And so you make a mess of things. So space war would last a few hours and then you'd never have another space war again. So space has been the repository of spy satellites ever since we've had satellites. And in that sense, it has been militarized. In fact, the Gulf War of 2003 was completely enabled by space assets, with GPS satellites leading the way. which we think of as just helping you get to grandma's house in your car, but it was conceived, launched, and operated by the military, and was later co-opted by business interests. So, yeah, it'll find grandma's house. Uber, their entire business model depends on it. And if you want to find a mate within 1.5 miles of your current location, swipe right.
Interplanetary hookups. I like the way you think, Neil.
You've heard me say it a million times. Wix is the best place to create your personal or professional website. I made wheelofscience.com on Wix. I found the perfect template, uploaded our content, and hit publish. It doesn't take an astrophysicist. That's why Neil didn't do it, and I did. No offense, Neil. Upgrade to a premium plan, and you can get your own website domain name right away. Go to wix.com/go/StarTalk and begin.
All right, you ready for another one?
Spin it.
Jay Tallis asks, what possible injuries or diseases will combat doctors in Space Force find themselves regularly treating?
That's a great question. Well, that depends on how much we invoke soldiers in space as opposed to remote controlled satellites in space. You start putting people in space, and then they start fighting one another. You might ask, well, why would you do that? Just put a drone satellite in space. But if you put people in space, yeah, then there's the long-term effects of zero G, the bone density loss, all the same things we currently know about from astronauts and their long-term visits to the International Space Station. So that's the kind of, I wouldn't call them injuries, but they're workplace hazards, I would call them. Workplace conditions that are not always in the interest of your health or your longevity. You also have exposure to higher levels of radiation from the sun, so you want to be protected against that. But if a missile hits you and you're blown to bits, same medical needs you might have if that happened on Earth.
The difference is when you scream medic in space, no one can hear you.
Yes, Chuck, that is true. Not only in space can no one hear you scream, no one can hear you explode either.
Man, bro, you went dark.
Just saying. Let's get real here.
All right, it's caption time. We took a picture of Neil and we put it up. And of course, we took captions from our viewers. And the winning caption is Peter Grell. I can count to two in my head, but starting at three, I gotta use my fingers.
That's my favorite one too, I must agree. In fact, it goes a little deeper with me because one of my favorite, most influential books growing up, beginning in middle school, was a book called 1-2-3 Infinity, written by the physicist George Gamow. And he referenced a tribe, a primitive tribe where they don't have numbers for anything bigger than three. They just can count up to three, and then after that, it's just very many. And so the question was, how do they think about large numbers relative to small numbers? So I like that. It's a throwback to a time when we really didn't have to count more than three things in our lives.
I just love that while you were reading 1-2-3 Infinity, I was reading 1-fish, 2-fish, red fish, blue fish, and that was in high school. Time now for this week's poll, which is, do you think we should have a space force? Answer right here on this page. All right, Neil, what do you think, huh?
You know, if we have a space force, then the Air Force motto, aim high, you lose to Space Force on that one because they're aiming higher. So I don't know how you're going to resolve that one, but.
So the Air Force would have to change their motto to lower your expectations.
And then the Space Force gets, the sky is not the limit, which happened to be the title of my memoir.
You know what I like most about that answer is the gangster way you slipped in your book plug. Yeah. Look at that, we're out of time. And of course, we have to say thank you to our very own personal astrophysicist, Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson. Thank you, Neil. Thank you again, Neil.
Till next time, Jack.
Total design freedom. That's what you get when you make a website using the Wix editor. You want motion background? Well, you got it. You want an online store? Well, that's a Wix feature. Animated page transitions? You guessed it, you can do it on Wix.
Yeah, I like this. Let's do it.
You can either use Wix ADI to let an artificial design intelligence build your site for you, or you can use their wide variety of templates to get exactly the site that you had in mind. Upgrade to a custom domain like we have at wheelofscience.com and let the world know about your site. So what are you waiting for? Go to wix.com/go/StarTalk and begin your site now. Believe me, if I can do it, you can do it. No way I'm as smart as you.
That's our show. We'll see you next time. I'm Chuck Nice. Thanks for watching Wheel of Science.